right, everybody, let's talk floods a little bit to go along with rivers. Starting with defining what a floodplain is. So if you picture this as the normal situation, this area of land that extends out to it, out to these outer banks, would be the floodplain, usually filled with sediments. And then during flooding circumstances, go figure, they're bound to flood, right? Which is like how they naturally work. They exist because of the nature of the river. This is one of those things, like, I don't want to use the term designed because it wasn't designed. It's just how, like, physics and geology work, that these things exist because of the nature of rivers. Now, humans having a relatively short life history here, moved into this area, let's say the Mississippi area, once geologically the scenario was already set and underway. And as it turns out, floodplains tend to be very fertile because the sediments and any organics that live within that, that flow around, when it floods, it gets spread out. And due to all the organics that are available in that, makes them really rich, fertile areas, right? So great for farming. Now, you know, we weren't the first people to notice this when North America was growing and growing and growing and farming built up in this valley. This, like, the Egyptians knew this, right? But being that we moved into there, you got to start to open the door to the ideas of what is the best way to, like, live and farm within these things when their existence is a thing because of the idea of flooding, right? It's like a obvious scenario to somebody that gets into the geology of rivers that this area looks the way it does because of flooding, pre-human, for a long, 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 long time. So if we show up and say, hey, we're going to farm here and build houses and simultaneously expect those houses and farms not to be flooded, there's a bit of a contradiction there, right? So here's like the block diagram of what it would look like in a textbook. Here's real life of what this confluence of these rivers look like in normal stage and in flood stage, filling up the floodplain, distributing those sediments, eventually going to retreat back into it. But again, now that there's so many people here, that can become problematic. So we try to engineer our way out of it, right? Which is a continuing study. It's not, you know, obviously we don't always nail it. And let's think about one of the places where this gets a little bit fouled up. Now, your textbook talks about levees kind of back up here within some of the stuff that I did in the last video. But I like this section right here is very clearly well-written. I really like it. So picture this scenario, regular river. This would be like coming out of the page. This is a cross-section view. And then during flood stage, it deposits these levees. Now the thicker, heavier stuff, just like our golden rule from the last video, is going to be the first to get deposited. And as the water slows, it will then drop all the rest of that sediment. Then when it retreats back into the channel, it's built itself some natural levees. That's like a normal scenario, right? So here's our problem. Let's do a floodplain. I'll be a little dramatic with how big it is. River. Should probably use a finer pen here. So the river's in here. And again, it may build up its natural levees. Now, in a normal scenario, pre-human, occasionally during a flood scenario, this would rise up, flood out the whole valley, deposit nice, rich organic soils on it, retreat back into the thing, perhaps building up its own little natural levees that will eventually be like overtopped when it floods the next time, right? So when we go and we say, okay, oh, no, didn't want that. Let me fix that. I won't make you watch it. One sec. All right, there we go. It's back. So when we humans show up, decide we're going to farm this thing and decide that we want to, with good intentions, protect some of this property, we'll build artificial levees of varying degrees of effectiveness. If you were around for the Katrina situation, we know that they're not always bulletproof. But let's think about what happens here. If this plain exists because occasionally the river floods and distributes its sediment, it still is going to do that. That's something we can't fight. That's like just reality. But what we'll do is go and build levees. So now let's think about it. Let's say there's a flood of moderate height. It gets up to here, floods, and drops its sediment. Now, the sediment that normally would be distributed over the whole entire basin now is constricted to in between those levees, and it will eventually get dropped off, right? So let's say that floodwater is gone, but now what you've done is you've made the ground actually physically higher. Maybe the stream channel kind of looks the same. But since all of the sediment that normally would be distributed outside of those levees in a natural situation is now constricted to within them, it gets dropped, but it gets dropped and raises it up higher than it is out here. So if you've built this house right here, yes, you are safe from that flood. Congrats. However, we're building up the case for the next one being worse. Let's say it happens again, but still doesn't overtop the levees. Then the sediment's going to build up more. And if you can play this forward in your head a couple of times and add eventually when a big flood does come, you've reduced the amount, like you've reduced how effective these things are essentially every single time they flood up to it. And eventually, then once this happens, you've got a lot more potential for it being a disastrous scenario, what we would call a disaster. Right? So it's the good and the bad of it. I'm not saying we should abandon all farms in the Midwest. People still got to eat, right? But we've got to develop an understanding for this and develop insurance like policies that make sense based on this. If you look up the history of NFIP, you'll see it's a bit of a disaster. It's a bit of a mess, no pun intended. And it really boils down to the fact that this stuff's not widely understood by the people that are designing these policies, right? It's a difficult scenario to try to engineer your way out of, to try to insure your way out of, but that's why we're here, right? We're learning some geology. So when it comes to where's my house in it, I wanted to bring up recurrence interval and this, like, what this 1% chance thing means. So if you have ever seen or heard on television, oh, that was a 50-year flood. Oh, that was a 100-year flood. What does that mean? Let's get into that a little bit. What they do, it's actually fairly simple. What you would do, and this section of the book right here on page 22 of the PDF explains it, is you could put them all in order by their discharge, which is just how much water would be going through a second, like a volume of water per time. You could put these all in order by that and then divide out like its position, its place by the number of pieces of data you have. And then you can get a probability. So like the worst one, the 2013 one right here, saying that that's going to happen once, they've got 96 years worth of data in this data sets. You get it down to a probability, a percentage of one. So when they say 100-year flood, that's nothing to do with it happening every 100 years. It's a probability. It's like a 1 in 100 probability or a 1% probability. If you had a 100-sided die and you rolled it, there's the very real chance that you roll the same number twice in a row. It's low, but it's there. There's nothing that says one number has to be 100 rolls away from another number. You know what I'm saying? And that's what recurrence interval does. I think I've always thought that it's like slightly misleading as a term. When you hear the 20-year flood, you say, oh, we just had one of those. We got a good 20 years. Nope, it just means that is the probability that it will happen in that given year. Right? So what potential problems are there with that? Well, first off, humans are only so old. We've only been collecting this data for so long. And yeah, 100 years is a long time, but is it compared to the existence of a river that's been there for a long time? Not necessarily. So if we were collecting data for a longer time back before areas were, you know, cities were even in existence, that'd be great, but we can't, right? So yes, we could use more data to really get better accuracy within that. Second is, I guess we could throw climate change in there as a second, but we're going to hold off on that until we're a little later in the course, but it's certainly relevant. So then third would be what's more relevant to this one is, what have humans done to the drainage basins? Does that land look different in the 19-teens and the 1920s? Did it look different then than it does now? What kind of things have we done to the surface that may change what happens when water hits the ground in terms of, excuse me, in terms of infiltration and runoff? So what those mean, and I guess I'll throw this on here, just like this will show up. read more on those if needs be. But what the idea is that when rain lands, water can either infiltrate, which means percolate its way down into the soil, or it can run off, which means works its way across the surface. So what kind of things have we done to the land that may alter that percentage and continue to do that to the land? Let's look. So this is Google Earth going back. They've got archived satellite imagery going back to 94, 95, somewhere around there. I don't know why it just flashed 95, but let's say 94. All right. This, if you're from the area south of Oswego, towards like Clay, where Route 481 comes down and Route 31 cuts across. You got Great Northern Mall over here, which is kind of in rough, having some rough days these days. Over here, you've got a Wegmans, a couple other things. Now, this is what this area looked like in 94, which would be when I was in high school. And then if we turn off, let me get my stupid head out of the way here. If we turn off historical imagery and go to today, watch what happens when I click this button. Very different scenario. What have we done? We've put in more shopping centers. I think those three are the original, but that's all new. That's all new. That's all new. We've got housing over here and here and here that was not there. So if you're put yourself in the perspective of a raindrop, if you were falling through the sky back here and you hit like a farmer's field, which still isn't as ideal as like the natural forest that would have been there before, but you hit it, you've got the chance to infiltrate down into the ground. If you're a raindrop falling in whenever this footage is taken, 2019, and you fall down and you hit asphalt, infiltration's done. It's going to be runoff. So all of the rain that hits all of that area, and if you were to calculate, I used to have lab students calculate this area, which isn't very difficult in Google Earth. You just run a little thing around it, see the area. If you get even a quarter inch of rain, a half an inch of rain that falls on that, it's a significant volume of water that's got to go somewhere, and it's got to go somewhere now. There's no longer infiltration happening with this, what we're going to call, sorry, I got too much open right now, what we're going to call impervious cover. So if you take an area, cover it with asphalt, rooftops, concrete sidewalks, things like that, that's now impervious. That's not going to allow for any more infiltration. And when that happens, it's got to go downhill somewhere and end up in the river systems. Now, there's not a ton of relief. There's not like a significant worry of flash flooding here. It's just, it's very local and a very notable change. So I think it's easy for people to spot if you go down there to Wegmans or Target or Barnes & Noble or any of the stuff that's down here. Consider it. Consider that that was a farmer's field back when I was in high school, which isn't even that long ago. So how does that affect the budget of rainfall going into the streams that are locally there? It's a big problem in Syracuse, and they've done some measures to try to account for it. So Onondaga Creek starts down towards Tully, flows its way north, and gets in through the valley and up into town here. So, I mean, look at how much impervious cover we have in a city the size of Syracuse, let alone larger ones. If you're a raindrop and you hit something, it's going to get washed into storm sewer systems and carried right down to the rivers, right? That was the response, the planned response for a long time, was put in the culverts on the roads, get the water in there, get it down to the river, and get it out. The problem is that if we could go back in time, say 300 years when this was all woods, 400 years when this is all woods, the water would soak in slowly. The size of that creek, again, I don't want to say designed because it's not a design, but the size of that creek by virtue of nature is a function of how long it would take water in this climate, in this region, to get down into it with this slope, with this relief. Now, all that water, boom, going right in there, will flood it. And that would happen periodically. It comes out right through here, through the Inner Harbor and out. There's sewage treatment at the end. The unfortunate scenario here was that there's some combined sewer and streets, sanitary sewers and the street ones that would wash down into that same plant. And if there was a heavy rainstorm and it was all happening at once, they had no choice but to open up the gates and just let it all go, which meant raw sewage was going right into what was already one of the most polluted lakes in the world. So the combined storm and sewer runoff is a bad problem. It was a bad idea. And Syracuse has made some good efforts to try to abate it. Up here, my old stomping grounds at Tip Hill, they've put in these rain gardens. And you can even still see in this, this is where they cut. So that's the old storm sewer that would have gone in and into culverts and downtown to the plant. Now they took them and they just ran them into this, which is basically a big hole in the grounds with plants that can tolerate the water like fluxing in during a heavy rainstorm and then slowly draining out. And you can make them like attractive features. These things are pretty nice. And that has kept water out of the out of that system. If you go to the zoo at all soon, there's a nice little display and there's talk about, there's little signs outside the entrance that tell you about how this all works. And that's the same idea. Those are rain gardens. There's a few more when you come into the zoo right down here. They've also done Save the Rain projects where they for free will give you rain barrels. So if you live in this neighborhood, look at the number of rooftops. They collect a lot of water. If we can get a bunch of houses to all put in a 55-gallon drum, I know 55 gallons on its own isn't a lot, but 55 gallons multiplied times the number of these houses can keep pressure off of that stormwater system and improve the chance of flooding and the quality of the water as you get down there. An interesting scenario with this. Let me look it up real quick. I'm going to be lazy and just pull up Google Images on it, but look up Ellicott City, Maryland flooding. This is really, from what it looks like, attributable to this. It looks like a nice little, doesn't look like a nice town here, right? But in conditions where it's not all completely destroyed, it looks like a nice little town. But what they've had, being an attractive place to live, is up basin of it, uphill of it, a lot of rapid developments. And when you put in a suburb and you put in storm sewer systems, yes, you get the water out of your neighborhood, but where's it going? And the city is in kind of a narrow gully going downstream. And with a lot of upstream development, they've had more frequent than would be anticipated severe flooding. And it's an ongoing issue, and it's one they're working on fixing, but it's that's the kind of the moral of the story that I want to get into, is how those the human use of the land alters the nature of what that recurrence interval may be. What do you think? Sound good? What I'm going to do, so I got this, I'll put it up there if you want to use it. And then I've got a quick PDF that's great that talks about the nature of this impervious cover versus natural areas. It's like an, it's like a two-page loaded with infographics kind of thing. So give that a good read too, and I'll maybe refer to that when we get to quiz time, which is coming soon. Thanks, everybody. Have a good day.